Okay, so it is 5 o'clock here in Poland, and it should be 8:30 in India. And yes, hello everyone. My name is Unnikrishnan. I am a PhD student in astronomy at the Jagiellonian University in Krakow, Poland. So today I would like to share some concepts about the dark part of our universe. Well, unfortunately, I am not able to show you my face due to some technical difficulties, but this is me, and I represent a team of international PhD students in the Astronomical Observatory of Jagiellonian University. So our team is called the Night Under the Stars, and we call ourselves NUTS. Well, what we do? So before the pandemic, we used to have public events in our observatory. This is our beautiful observatory. It is located a few kilometers away from the main Krakow city center. And during our events, we used to do it once every month. And during each event, we had one small talk on any simple but interesting topic related to astronomy. Then we used to have a tour around the observatory. It is a really beautiful place, and those who have been in the observatory would really know that. And we used to have a tour around the observatory, showing the telescopes, and this is and the radio telescopes and all the optical telescopes. And we have a very good museum also, and that all included in the tour. Plus, we also conducted sky watch sessions. If the weather was good, we used our optical telescope to watch objects like moon, planets, etc. But unfortunately, right now, due to the pandemic, due to the regulations, we are not able to do it. So we decided to conduct this event online through our Facebook page. Every week, one of us talks about some simple but really interesting topic in astronomy for around 20 to 40 minutes through our Facebook page. So today I'm here as a part of that, and I would like to talk about the darkness around us. So actually, first of all, I thank everyone for joining the event in the Facebook Live. So I'm sorry that there's a delay in the broadcast. So whatever you so by the time I say something and you respond, and by the time the response reach me, it takes some time. So sorry for that, but I would be but it wouldn't be that bad. So please use the comment section to communicate with us. So though I am talking, we are a set of as I shown before, we are a set of people behind working on it. So please use the comment section to ask questions or give suggestions or comments, and we would try to reply to that. So here we go. Now this is Krakow, the beautiful city of Krakow in Poland. So this is for people who are not from Krakow. Our observatory is situated in near to the city, and once we zoom out from our city, we see that okay, so here is Krakow in Poland. This is the country Poland, and here is Krakow. And well, we all know that Poland is in a continent called Europe. And we further zoom out, we are living on this beautiful planet called Earth. Now, also we know that Earth is a part of a system of planets and star called the solar system, in which the Earth along with its planets, along with other planets, are rotating around a star called the Sun. This is the view that we have right now, but long ago our view was something different. We were thinking that okay, our Earth is something special, and Earth is at the center of the entire universe, and all other objects are moving around Earth. That was called geocentric model of the universe. But later and now we know that it's not right, and Sun is at the center of the solar system, and it's called a heliocentric model. Now I have a small question to all. So what do you think about the person who established the heliocentric model? So there's a famous scientist who established the heliocentric model. And could you please guess, please use the comment section to write your guess. Let's see, I'll be reading out the first five comments. Yes, I'm waiting. Please use the comment section to give your guesses, like which scientist established the heliocentric model. I mean, which scientists established that Sun is at the center of the solar system and not Earth. Yeah, Night and the Star says Nicolas Cage. Okay, my father, Suresh Kumar, father said Copernicus. Okay, so we have some clues also in the comments. Yes, more guesses. Okay, Shubhrada says Nicholas Copernicus. Okay, yes, actually it is Nicholas Copernicus. So thank you for the guesses. Yes, so Copernicus established that Sun is at the center of our solar system. Now, yes, our solar system, once we further zoom out from our solar system, we see that our Sun and our planets are in a galaxy. What is the name of the galaxy? Yet another thing for you to comment. Please comment what is the name of the galaxy in which our solar system is. It's a very beautiful name which we all have our own regional language variations. All the names are really beautiful. Yes. Okay, I can see. Yes, the comments. Okay, my father Suresh Kumar, my father, he says Milky Galaxy. Okay, then okay, Nuts again says it's not Andromeda. Okay, right. Shudrata says it's Milky Way. Okay, she again gives the Indian version of the name, Agast Ganga. Okay, yes, so yes, the name of our galaxy is the Milky Way. And one interesting thing that we can see here is that, so this is the galaxy and this is the center of the galaxy, and we are here. So we are here, and this is around this much kilometers away from the center, which is like around 17 zeros after 2, after 2, around 0.5, then around 17 zeros. So that many kilometers we are away from the galactic center. So this is something really, really big from our point of view, right? Like we deal with 100 or 200 or 1000 max kilometers in our daily life, and we in our galaxy we are away from our center this many kilometers, so which is something really great. Now, what is a galaxy? So galaxy is a combination, a group of stars which are bound together by gravity. So we know that, okay, we have studied that there is something called gravity which is acted upon by mass. So if there is a mass, there is a gravity which will attract other masses. So stars, it has mass. So when stars are together, each the mass of each star influence other stars and they form a bound structure. Such a structure is called a galaxy. Now, so this is the Milky Way galaxy that we can see from Earth, because we are on one of the arms of the Milky Way. We cannot see just like how we saw here, right? So we have to, we will see our Milky Way like this as a patch. Well, this is from the Paranal Observatory in Chile, because they have a very good atmospheric condition and very less light pollution. It would be really great to see Milky Way from there, and unfortunately our cities and our towns are full of light pollution and we do not have enough atmospheric conditions to see Milky Way like this. Now we were in Milky Way, and further we are zooming out from Milky Way, then we see that our Milky Way is a part of a group, like just like stars bound together by gravity, galaxies can also form groups of galaxies or clusters of galaxies to form gravitationally bound systems. So the group in which Milky Way is a part is called the local group. Zooming out further, these groups further create or further attract other groups of galaxies to form superclusters. These superclusters further, on a larger view, again are gravitationally influenced by other structures, other superclusters, and this forms forms giant structures of the universe. So further we zoom out, we see the structures. You can see here, so this is like you can see a filamental structure here, you can see some filamental structures here. These are called structures, and at the end the whole universe is a large scale structure. I will just show a computer simulated three-dimensional view of a universe. So here we go. Yes, so this is a three-dimensional structure of the large scale of the universe, and each point here you see are galaxies. Yes, so now we are near a giant cluster of galaxies where you can see many galaxies are lying together. This is called a giant cluster, and now we are zooming out from the cluster and you can see some structures, like see filamental structures, filamentous structures here, and we can see even regions where there are very less number of galaxies too. Yes, so this is called Millennium Simulation. Yes, we can simulate the whole universe in our computer. So this is what one picture of the simulation says. Here again you can see structures like the filaments, the clusters of galaxies, then there are regions called voids where you do not have enough structure. So just imagine this scale, it is written 125 megaparsec. Megaparsec is just a unit of representing distance in astronomy. It is corresponding to about 3 into 10 raised to 21 kilometers, which is like right 3 and right 10, 21 zeros, and that many kilometers is just this structure, what you see here. And that's why we say our universe is vast. Now, this is what we believe to be the entire universe, like the cosmic web that we just saw, the Lasky structure, whatever we see, the galaxies, the clusters, the superclusters. We believe that this is it. But it's not that simple. Things were not that smooth. See, as I said before, the galaxies, even in our Milky Way, our solar system is moving around the galactic center. So all the galaxies are rotating. Now, the speed of the galaxy rotation is pretty important. You can see here, this is a software developed rotation of a galaxy. You can see that the galaxy is rotating, and how fast a galaxy is rotating is dependent on how much matter does the galaxy has. So here what you get as a person from the Earth is a light from the galaxy. Using the light, you can estimate how much mass does it have, and there are different techniques for that. And using the mass, you can predict how fast the galaxy can rotate. That is what you can see here. This is a prediction. This is an expectation from our theory. Now, you can see the plot here. It is just showing how fast the galaxy rotates from the center of the galaxy. So here is the center. You go further, you can see that the galaxy's speed decreases. That's what you can see here. Now, this is, as I said, this is a prediction. But when we really observed, we saw something different. So you can figure out the difference quite easily. Now, in reality, the galaxies, especially the outer region of the galaxies, rotate faster than we expect. That is what you can see here. Instead of decreasing the speed remains almost constant, which means the outer regions of the galaxies are affected by something that we really do not see. Okay, we know that there is some mass for the galaxy, and we predicted the speed, but we see more speed than we predicted in the regions away from the galactic center. This was something confusing the scientists back then. Like, what can be the thing that is causing this discrepancy? So that made us think again, that is it all that we observe? Like, if that is all what we observe, we shouldn't have seen a different rotation speed for the galaxy. Or something is there that we can't see, because we were estimating the mass from the light that we get. Maybe there was more of something which was not visible to us. Yeah, but we know something about it, that it has mass, right? Because since it has mass, it was affecting the rotation. So whatever which has mass, we call it matter. So we know that it is matter, but we cannot see it. So we named it the dark matter. Yes, so this is the dark matter, that is something that we didn't expect before, but that was affecting our real observations. There are a few interesting phenomena that are caused due to the dark matter. For example, gravitational lensing. So a few classes before, our team member Sayed did a talk on the space-time, gravity and everything, and he explained how the mass of an object curves the space-time like this, as you can see here. So when you have a curved space-time, light coming through that also bends its path, just like how the motion of your car or something which takes a curved path when there's a curve on the road. Now this is just a pictorial representation. So here are we, Earth, we are observing from here, and imagine there is a very massive object here. It can be a galaxy or a cluster of galaxies or something, and there is another object which are farther away. So the light from the farther away object, if this object was not here, the light would have directly reached us. But since this object is there, the heavy object, the massive object, it bends the space-time, and due to the bending of the space-time, the light takes a curved path and reaches us. This apparently makes us think, or we see, that this object is not entirely at the backside of this massive object, but on the sides. So we see different images of the same object. This is called gravitational lensing. Now, gravitational lensing happens even without dark matter. But what we see from this massive object, what we see when we convert the light into mass, when we predict the mass, that mass is not enough to curve, deviate the light that much. So that warns us that there is something extra mass that we do not see. That is dark matter. Yes, so dark matter plays a very important role in this gravitational lensing. Well, though it is dark and it's apparently something scary, it is not in reality. It gives us some very beautiful pictures. Yes, this is a very beautiful picture of gravitational lensing, where what you see here is a very massive object, and this one is one galaxy, just like our Milky Way, far away from us, but the light from that galaxy got bent due to the mass of this center object and reaches us, and we see that galaxy as a ring. This is called Einstein's ring, because Einstein did many work based on this. Yes, I have more. Here, this center object is one massive object, and these four things that you see is actually the image of one single point object. Yes, so actually what we see are apparent positions of that object, which are the light from that object which reach us in a curved path. That curvature is caused due to the mass of this object. Yes, this is a combination of different gravitational lensing effects. Yes, you can see many structures here. Here, these are caused due to the central. So this is a cluster of galaxies. You can see many galaxies together. So that creates this this very interesting structures or images in our telescope. Now, from all these, what do we know about dark matter? Yes, it is not visible because we cannot see it. It interacts only gravitationally. Yes, we cannot see it, that's right, but it interacts gravitationally. It affects the masses near it. That's why we saw different rotation speeds for the galaxy, and we see gravitational lensing and yet another. There are many other observational evidences for dark matter which is like too much to be covered in one small talk. And it actually matters, because that's what we have to take into account, dark matter, in all our observations, because it is of a huge quantity. We'll talk about the quantity, how much dark matter is there later on. Now, if you think that the darkness of our universe ends there, it doesn't. There is something more. Let's see what it is. Well, in the last event of our Night Under the Stars, Subrata talked about the universe which is expanding. So yes, it was Edwin Hubble, scientist. He observed that all the galaxies are moving away from each other. The farther the galaxies are, the faster the galaxies are moving away from each other. It is just like imagine you put raisins in the bread dough before putting it for baking, and when the bread rises, all the raisins move away from each other, right? So each raisin will think that, okay, all of the raisins are moving away from me. Just like that, when we observe from Milky Way, we see that all the galaxies are moving away from us. But that is just because we are standing in Milky Way and looking. Actually, all the galaxies in the universe are moving away from each other. And later, it was discovered that this expansion is not just plainly expanding, but it is speeding up. That is, our universe is accelerating on itself, which was something that we didn't know before. And now, what pushes all the galaxies away from each other? This is something strange. Okay, we think that the expansion, if you plot it back, you see that the universe all came from a point. That's how we say the Big Bang happened. But then later on, due to the mass what we have, plus we also have the dark matter, all this dark matter and the visible matter should bring back all the galaxies, right? How? Because it's all gravity and it attracts each other. But that's not what we see. We see that the galaxies are repelling, they are moving away from each other. So there is some mysterious thing that is playing the role. And since we do not know about it, we just call it dark energy. So that's it about dark energy. We really do not know much about dark energy and dark matter too, because we do not know what are the constituents of dark matter. There are several theories behind it. Like it's a new type of elementary particle. We call it WIMP, weakly interactive massive particles. But we are the scientific world is still researching on that, and there are more to know. So, as a whole, our universe, what we see, is not entirely what it is, as we have seen. So it is around 68% dark energy, then around 27% of dark matter, and 5% is only what we see. Yes, just imagine whatever I have shown, especially compare it with the distance scale, what we see with our eyes, or maybe not with our eyes, by seeing means we can observe in using telescopes also. So what we observe as matter, luminous matter is just 5%. So that means the darkness overrules the universe. Our universe is mostly invisible to us. This is something really, really incredible. Well, this is just a night sky of a night view of our world. You can see major cities, like some countries and major cities are emitting a lot of light. But there are other regions which are dark. Here it's dark, but that doesn't mean that there is nothing, right? So we have things over there, just that it is not giving us light. Dark matter and dark energy is just like that. It is there and it is a lot, and it doesn't give us anything to see. So thank you so much for being with us for this talk, and please comment down your questions. Yes, I will just have a look at the comment session. I'll wait for a few minutes for your questions. Please write it down, and I'll be waiting for it. So we have a question. Is it the same phenomenon of solar eclipse? Well, it actually bending of light happens during solar eclipse, and it was actually used as an observational proof for the theory of Einstein that the mass bends space-time and the light takes a curved path. That was the solar eclipse was used for that purpose. It was proved by Eddington, famous scientist. But the actual thing behind solar eclipse can be, okay, there are different solar eclipses that we see. There are partial, there are complete solar eclipses, and sometimes we see ring of the light. But that is actually, that can be because the size, apparent size, is different from the entire. So that when the moon, when it hides the sun, that the size or apparent size of the moon won't be big enough to hide the sun. So that can be the reason why we see a ring. But at the same time, light bends there, but very small amount, because the it always depends on the mass of the object. So the mass is not that massive enough to give us a very huge observational thing to see that, okay, it bends so much. Yes, yeah, bending of light happens during solar eclipse too. Thank you for the comments. So I will wait one more minute to see if there are more questions. If not now, you can always use our Facebook page or Okay, so we have an interesting question by Lech Yashovsky. So what do you think, dark matter is consist of what? Well, it is quite tricky. So right now the major, though we haven't proved it much, the biggest or the greatest idea could be the WIMP, where, yes, it's WIMP, it's weakly interactive massive particles. So it is not interacting much, so it is very hard to find out what is behind the dark matter. So theories, this particle physics and the elementary particles, they all expect the wimp, but it has to get a well well formulated proof, which is okay. We are waiting for it. Any more questions? Okay, so I think that the questions are over from the comment section. I cannot see more questions. So please follow our Facebook page, Night Under the Stars. Every week we'll be having a similar and more interesting talks. Okay, we have one more question left. When we will know? Well, I'm not sure. I'm so sorry, I cannot answer that now. It's actually a collaboration between astrophysicists and the particle physicists. So when the collaboration becomes more fruitful, maybe then we will know. What is the size of the universe approximately? Well, talking about the size of the universe is a bit tricky because we have to take into account the time also there. So I can now say it is 13.8 billion years, which is the size of the observable universe, because that is what we observe. But there are more, because the light from the farther regions of the universe hasn't got enough time to reach us. So that doesn't mean that the whole universe is only that much. That much is our observational, observable universe, yes. 13.8 billion years. Okay, so please use our Facebook page, follow it, and attend all our coming sessions. And you can always message our Facebook page for if you have any doubts regarding any points in any topics in astronomy. So thank you. Have a nice time. Stay safe. And let's hope that soon the pandemic will be over and we'll all be able to let you in the observatory for real.